I'm Ashley Chancellor.
I'm Dakota Chancellor.
I'm Robert Ortegon.
I'm Bo Maddox.
And we are Collateral Gaming with
Collateral Cinema.
Welcome to Collateral Gaming, the only video game podcast that matters, where we focus on good games, bad games, and everything else in between in the world of gaming. And today we are here with our parent podcast, Collateral Cinema Movie Podcast.
Woo!
Hey everybody.
What's up?
So this is our very first collaboration special with Collateral Cinema. I wanted to come back into the new year with just a little something special for you guys. We needed a little bit more time to get on a right schedule to get our Infamous out. And that is coming out next within 2 weeks. But I wanted to throw something out there. So I thought we could do this. And when I thought about doing a collab with Collateral Cinema, I had to think of something that was both a movie and a game at the same time. And the first thing that came to mind is a movie that's been trending lately, actually. It just came out this month. And that is Black Mirror Bandersnatch.
Yeah, it's pretty popular on Netflix, and it's easy to find. It's hard to miss.
Bandersnatch, more like Bander shit.
But it's a really cool premise, at least. It's the idea of, it's like a choose-your-own-adventure-style Netflix movie where you'll actually make choices that influence the characters in the story. Now, we're going to try to stick away from spoilers. So, Bandersnatch is actually a part of the Black Mirror franchise. Which is a TV series. Now, this is its own TV movie special. Bo and Robert, y'all haven't seen Black Mirror, have you?
No, I certainly haven't. And after this, I'm not sure if I'm going to come back to it.
No, I haven't. Just the movie.
Well, it's actually kind of an anthology series, so none of this is actually really connecting. And it's written by several different writers and directors. So the thing with Black Mirror is if you watch one episode and you don't like it, you know, you can come back and you'll find something probably you will like. For instance, I'm not a fan of the first episode. I think a lot of people aren't. Now, Dakota, maybe you could run us a little bit through what Black Mirror is for the audience.
Yeah, after I researched it a bit, I believe it's called a satirical psychoparanoia. It's kind of the genre. It's pretty interesting. It always has a futuristic vibe to it. And there's always like a technological advancement, you know?
Like the dangers of technology.
Yeah.
You and I, we've both seen all of Black Mirror, right?
I think I've seen every episode, I believe.
I think I'm missing like a little bit of the fourth season, but yeah.
Something like that. They're really good episodes. What's nice about them is they're all standalone.
Yeah.
It's a TV show like The Twilight Zone. Every episode is standalone, but it has a different cast and everything.
Right, right.
And so it's really cool. Like you said, different directors, different writers, different producers. And it's really cool. I love the format of the show itself.
Some of the episodes seem to take place in the same universe, but for the most part, they don't really have anything to do with each other.
Uh-huh.
Now, Black Mirror as a whole, like Dakota said, it explores kind of themes like the dangers of technology, where it could take us. Usually, most of the episodes are set in the near future or a couple of them in actually the contemporary present. Not only that, but Black Mirror also usually generally has kind of a dark twist to it somewhere throughout. Oftentimes, the protagonist ends up being not so great of a person. You kind of find out some dark secrets or they're led down a dark pathway and kind of the rabbit hole. So Bandersnatch, of course, you guys, do you think that kind of matches up with that?
I don't know. I think so.
Not so much the technology aspect, but like the dark twist, pretty meta. Not usually fourth wall breaking, but, you know, kind of meta, kind of self-aware.
Yeah, it goes, you know, double, triple meta. I mean, you get full into it, you know. There's a point in it where it brings in Netflix. I don't want to spoil anything, but it brings in its own platform to kind of advertise a little bit for it.
I don't want to spoil anything, but here it is.
Yeah, here it is. Yeah, we just totally spoiled everything.
Spoil everything.
That's funny.
There's a certain pathway that does allow you to get, in particular, very meta. So within Bandersnatch, of course, though, there's an additional element to the story that's not in previous Black Mirror episodes. Now, I said before, this is its own like TV special. It's actually got a separate listing on Netflix. But what's different about this one is that Black Mirror Bandersnatch is a like I said before, a choose-your-own-adventure style movie. The first of its kind, as far as I'm aware. There's some video games that are kind of like this. In fact, Bandersnatch is about game development, but we'll get to that in a minute. But the thing with this is that you, the viewer, will actually get to make choices for the protagonist, Stefan. And at certain points, you'll even get to rewind and see different endings. In fact, from what I believe, there's 5 main endings, but there's several different variants of those. The movie throughout actually keeps track of what endings you've come to. When it rewinds, it leads you down different pathways. And
almost like an algorithm.
Yeah, yeah. And it remembers which paths you've been through.
It's kind of creepy if you think about it.
That is creepy. It's like it's haunted or something.
And that itself can affect the plot or at the very least some of the characters.
Or it could just be Netflix collecting data from user algorithms. How about that, people? Maybe that's what it is.
That's what Facebook does to it.
Yeah, it's Facebook.
Of course the vegan would say that.
Oh, really now? God.
Teach you about being vegan. Damn it.
Now, how do you guys think that format influences the narrative of the movie?
In the most obvious way possible. You're the one choosing it, and nobody has any free will. It's meta for no reason, and I don't know.
We'll stay away from spoiler territory, but I think that's a key aspect of the experience, is that the characters themselves are aware. At least one or two characters are aware that you are, including Stefan, are aware that you are making choices for them at a certain point. Now, bringing up Stefan, Robert, what did you think about the protagonist?
He was kind of a weird little kid taking drugs.
Yeah.
He was boring is what he was. Boring.
Was he a Frodo, Bo?
A Frodo? No, he was worse than that. Much worse than a Frodo. None of the characters in this was interesting at all. None of them.
You didn't even like Colin's character by Will Poulter?
Yeah, I found him annoying and insufferable.
Oh, man.
He was insufferable. I was just like, he's just a narrative device to tell him about, you know, all these different paths he can take. It's like, oh, okay, great job, guys. Whatever.
So, Colin's an interesting character. I thought he was kind of cool about how he's the only other character that seems to transcend the narrative. Of course, we'll talk about Colin a little bit more, but Stefan, do you think that he has kind of a set personality, or is it completely influenced by the viewer?
I believe it's a little bit of both, but there is a script to his personality.
Right.
And there are some things you have to end up doing.
Yeah.
So that's kind of, whether you wanted to do something else or not, you have to follow this personality. But there are times where you choose a different song. You know, it's just that's a different personality type.
Yeah.
So
he's set in his ways in certain times. And in your attempt to get to a good ending of the story, you know, you end up finding out that Stefan continually wants to make the same mistakes again and again.
That's the Black Mirror of this.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. And it's really interesting how the other characters kind of react to that as well. We did mention Colin before, who's the second most interesting character, and for some people, the most interesting character. Apparently, Will Poulter will return as Colin Rittman, possibly in another Black Mirror episode.
Really, that's cool. I would like that. And he's a really cool character, really interesting.
Yeah, and he kind of brings the protagonist on that acid trip. We don't want to go too much into it, but that in particular is a scene that influences the narrative as a whole.
His character is very, omnipresent.
Yeah.
His wild scene, dude.
Yeah. I will say, at one point, he says that PAC in Pac-Man stands for Program and Control. And that is not true, ladies and gentlemen. Huh. It is not true.
It's not true. It's bullshit.
If anybody watched Scott Pilgrim, everyone knows that Pac-Man was originally Puck-Man from the Japanese Paku. And Puck sounded too much like fuck, so they changed it to PAC. But Colin Rittman seems to think it means Program and Control.
Yeah, well, Colin Rittman thinks a lot of fucking things.
The Colin Rittman?
Yeah, this character thinks and says a lot of different things.
Did you guys think there were any other characters that stood out?
No.
No.
None of them
Just
did.
The weird guy in his room.
Mm-hmm. No, none of them stood out at all.
The psychiatrist.
She wasn't even that great. She was in Dark Place.
Only in that one ending.
Yeah, there was one ending where it gets kind of interesting.
Oh, that was...
Don't you think there should be a little more action, though?
Oh, God. That's where things officially just went off the rails for me, and I was just like,
okay,
no.
This is Donnie Darko. No.
This is Donnie Darko, and then it's The Truman Show, and then it's Groundhog's Day, and then it's... What the fuck else is it, Robert? It's...
That's pretty much it, right?
Yeah. It's literally just taking from better movies and making something that's not nearly as good as that. You know, that's what I see here. I mean, the Choose Your Own Adventure thing, for one, it's a Futurama joke, for one. Futurama predicted this shit.
That's right. There was an episode of Futurama where they...
and what did they get Calculon to do? Do his fucking taxes. And that's what it felt like in some of these pathways. It's like, I mean, the idea itself just isn't that novel.
Pay attention.
It's not novel at all. Seriously. I don't even care about the characters. I don't care about the pathways. I mean... It doesn't even seem to really go that deep into the whole parallel universe thing anyways. It's just pretty much the same fucking bullshit over again. There's nothing about this that's intelligent. There's nothing about this that is interesting. I did not vibe with this.
That's cool. All right. I respect that. You've probably seen a lot of these tropes before, and for someone that's a fan of David Lynch, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean...
Some of these twists might not be surprising.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't waste your time with this. Watch Inland Empire. That's all I'm going to say. Inland fucking Empire. You want meta? That's meta.
Well...
That's deeply meta. That's so meta, it's almost painful to even scratch at the surface of it. It's so fucking meta.
I will say, I don't think any of the elements in this movie in and of itself are anything original. But I think the way in which it's put it together, for me anyway, it made it really interesting. I tried really hard to get a good ending. You know, at least my first watch through. And then the opposite watch through. The second one, I kind of wanted to make all the opposite choices and see what happened. But I was really trying hard and I was invested. And I think it's the pressure, the tension of I can make this decision and it can fuck up the whole story.
Yeah.
You know?
I like in some of the story parts where you would go to make a decision, one of the two options, and then it wanted the other option. And so the characters in the show would start to say things like, hey, you should choose the other option, basically. And I think that was really cool. It got a little meta there.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, it was interesting. Now, one of the things that makes this movie kind of near and dear specifically to my heart is that the main character, Stefan Butler, he's a game developer. And I myself am an aspiring indie game developer. So I think the setting of this is really interesting. Bandersnatch takes place for the first time in the Black Mirror series, actually not in the present or the future, but the past in 1984. So we've got this 1980s setup where video games are kind of just starting out. And we've got Stefan, who always wanted to create a computer game. He's read this Choose Your Own Adventure book called Bandersnatch. Apparently, Netflix might be getting in trouble for using the label Choose Your Own Adventure. Did you hear about that?
Really?
That's not surprising.
Is that like a copyright thing?
Apparently. I wondered about that when they mentioned it, too. But anyway.
What about Pac-Man?
Pac-Man?
That's another one.
That's in the common.
That's true.
That's in the Creative Commons, I believe.
Yeah, because that Pixel movie used it.
Yeah, Pixels. Now, Bandersnatch within the narrative is a book that Stefan finds and is really intrigued by with a character the writer, Jerome F. Davies, who his character is also explored in the movie. And you'll kind of see how Stefan can follow in the footsteps and kind of go down the same rabbit hole that Davies does when he was writing this book with Divergent Pathways, which Stefan is adapting into the video game Bandersnatch.
And you know what? Come to think of it, that whole pretense where, you know, he's like this prodigy that's at the top of his game and he's trying to push himself even further and further. You know what it reeks of? Black Swan. It's pretty much the same character motivations. Seriously. Once again, it's borrowing from another movie. Even there. Jesus Christ, man.
Well, I do kind of see that archetype in there. Of course, Stefan is kind of molded by the player's actions. Your main goal within the movie is to create a 5-star game, albeit you want to do it without murdering anyone or dying. But that does definitely proves difficult.
Keep having these vivid dreams, like thinking weird things. What sorts of things?
We're gonna be a hit factory, like Motel, but for computer games. You heard it here first.
Bandersnatch.
It's an adventure game
based on the book. Jerome F. Davies was a genius.
See that bloke who went cuckoo and cut his wife's head off?
When it's a concert piece, a bit of madness is what you need.
You're not hearing voices, or...
No voices, but there is something.
Bandersnatch was the final straw.
It lets you see the bigger picture.
Stefan, you're worrying me.
Leave Stefan out of this.
Leave Stefan. Your fate has been dictated.
You're not in control.
So I thought the setting was at least interesting. Did you guys at least kind of vibe with the 1980s setting?
It didn't even feel that 80s to me, honestly.
I think the first It felt more 80s to me.
Seriously, it didn't even really
Mandy
cap-
felt Man- 80s.
Mandy felt 80s as fuck. We watched 80s. Mandy the other night. Oh my God.
Yeah, that was great.
That movie. Can we? I want to talk about that movie.
Yeah, that movie's great.
That movie is amazing. Nicolas Cage. Oh my God.
He's at his cagiest, bro. You got to see it.
At his cagiest. The one true God himself.
Your differing opinions need to leave.
Oh, what the fuck?
We're trying to talk
ever.
About this episode.
Keep your negativity out of 2019.
Oh, God damn it.
Ruining our podcast, Bo. You're just a guest
ruining
star.
Ruining your podcast? I am the podcast now.
No, you're just a guest star.
I am the Senate.
Also a producer.
So it's treason then.
It's treason. Treason. Yeah, exactly. Treason. Vote of no confidence in all of you. Nah, I'm just playing. So, yeah, we're totally playing Grand Theft Auto 3 while we're doing this.
Yeah,
that's why they're not saying much. They're too distracted.
Gaming podcast. We thought we'd bring some games.
Yeah.
Distracted.
Some games.
If you're playing Bandersnatch.
I think we should do Grand Theft Auto at some point in the podcast, right?
That'd be interesting.
Y'all totally should.
Because they do have actually decent campaign, I've been told.
Grand Theft Auto?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I played a little bit of it. Mostly, you know, you just want to get your flying car around. Fly your flying car around.
Turn everything silver or... whatever.
Yeah. Well, you know, whatever is better than Bandersnatch.
You know, it's I mean, if you think about it, I mean, it is a choose your own adventure. GTA. Yeah.
No? It's the ultimate choose your own adventure.
You are making all the decisions. Good, bad, no matter how it ends.
No one else was a good game. Earthbound.
That was random, Bo.
Yeah.
Earthbound kind of has similar vibes, yeah.
Yeah, Earthbound movies. Is really,
but
really
maybe
cool.
Done even better.
Way better. Are you kidding me? Earthbound is classic.
I guess we can wrap up kind of our thoughts on this here. But
Yeah.
For me, Bandersnatch, it's not bad. I mean, it's not perfect, but I kind of vibed with Black Mirror before. I was interested in the universe or the multiverse, whatever they're going for there. And I like the themes it represents. I like the tension. I like the choose your own adventure format. I think the takeaway here is what could Netflix or Black Mirror, you know, any show do with this format in the future? I think it could be implemented really well with other movies. What do you think?
I don't know. The execution here, it's just so makes me feel so blasé that, I mean, I don't feel like I want to really even try to get into movies like that. I mean, I feel like it's going against that old adage of telling a story, you know, show don't tell. Mm-hmm. It feels like it's kind of telling the story to you, even though you have the choice.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this. So Netflix has, this is their first time ever doing an interactive anything.
Yeah.
Netflix.
Yeah.
And so do you see a future?
Do I see a future?
Interactive.
They're probably going to push it a little bit, but I think that it's going to be a minor thing. It'll be a blip on the radar. And by this time next year, people aren't even going to remember this shit.
Think so?
Yeah, seriously. That's
I'm gonna
what I
mark
think.
Your words, Bo.
Yeah, that's my prediction. This is a tiny little blip on that radar. It's, I mean, I guess I can give it some credit for trying to be interactive, but it's just, I feel like it could have been done better. And then there's just all the derivative elements of it to me. And the fact that it's a Futurama joke. This is a Futurama joke, people.
So do you think that it being as meta as it is, connecting the choose your own adventure style to the actual in the story mode, do you think that's a good thing they did? Or do you think it would have been better without
I
that?
I think that it's a novel concept. It's just, I think that it would have been better if it was released as a physical DVD or game or something like that.
Yeah. Okay. So if you were to see,
play it with puzzles, I guess.
Right? Yeah. Play it with puzzles. Cause I know that back in the day when Blu-ray first came out, they tried doing something similar to this. It was a feature on most Blu-rays. There was something, if I recall, it was kind of like a more of an extended commentary type thing. And you can kind of go into you could even kind of see different, like deleted scenes and everything. You could see how that scene would fit into the movie.
Yes.
And shit.
I remember using my Blu-ray player and playing games on the DVDs.
Yeah.
Some the kids' movies.
Like yeah.
That's my childhood.
So, it's not like this hasn't been tried before. And honestly, if you want a game that actually does this concept well, check out on the PS3 Heavy Rain. Like that is that's an actual game that feels cinematic because of the choices that are made in that.
Or Until Dawn, have you heard of that one?
Until Dawn is another good example. Yeah.
Well, you know what this reminded me of? The Telltale game series. You know, The Walking Dead. I also did a Batman series, Tales from the Borderlands, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yes, those are great.
They folded recently though.
Yeah, I heard about that. That's kind of disappointing because I really like that game format. I think it was interesting and that actually gives you more options. More often than not, you have, I think, three dialogue choices plus the option to say nothing.
See, that's much more compelling, and keeping it within a gaming framework, it makes more sense. This right here just doesn't make sense to me. And once again, it feels like Netflix just trying to adjust their algorithms by getting data off of their viewers. That's what it feels like. It's like, do y'all like this type of story with this type of ending? Or do you like that type of story with that type of ending? And I get that you need to do some type of market research on this sort of thing, but I don't know. It seems kind of underhanded to put it under the guise of an interactive experience when, honestly, that's just what this feels like. It's data collection. That's what this feels like to me.
Yeah. Well, I think in the future, that format, I mean, this is just the starting point. I think that format could be used if implemented properly. You know, maybe a gaming format would be better, but I kind of felt like it was lacking in terms of scope. There were certain, I feel like they could have done more with the choices is all.
Yeah.
And I actually like this. I enjoyed the experience, but I do see where they could have improved on that formula. What do you think, Dakota?
Yeah, I mean, well, let me ask you. I asked Bo already, but what do you think? Do you think that if there were more interactive episodes, movies, whatever like this, do you think that it being meta would be important to it? Do you think that's a good aspect and that most of them should follow that? Follow that characters know that you're making decisions or there's some reason that you're making decisions, you know?
I like the concept a lot. It really surprised me. I saw it right away. Like Bo said, I mean, it is kind of predictable, but in a way, that sometimes works because it makes the viewer feel smart. Like, oh, I figured this out. You see this element used a lot in gaming in particular.
Yeah, but don't you find that a little bit patronizing, though?
I suppose.
A little bit.
You know, during the movie, I didn't think about that. You know, I had a good time. And like I said, I was really pressured into trying to make a 5-star game without killing anyone to do it.
but also, I mean, as far as it being meta in order for that framework to work, I think that it could work in just regular linear structure.
Yeah.
Just keep it linear, just different paths. And honestly, I think that that's really what made Bandersnatch so weak in my eyes, honestly. Okay. One of many, 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 many different things about it.
See, I liked the sense of challenge. Yeah. You get a sense
what
of challenge.
Though?
Well, you get it though. When you're watching the movie, you like Ash said, you want to get a 5-star game. Yeah. And so there's a challenge. Okay, what's the right answer? You know, which one will give me the 5-star game? What path is the best, movie type path?
But it's going to do that one way or the other unless you hit, skip to credits. You know, it pretty much is going to hold your hand right back to those other choices that diverge to other paths.
I believe it eventually will.
It just starts you over.
Eventually, it will cut to credits. I think about after 90 minutes or after you've explored all the pathways. But I think what's cool is that the rewind feature, which is just like in Choose Your Adventure books where it says to go back to page this or whatever. I think it's cool because it does keep track, like I said before, of what paths you've been on. And there are certain paths you can only get to having rewinded from a game over.
But that brings me to another thing about the Choose Your Own Adventure format here. To me, it only really makes sense either in a video game or a textual, you know, construct, you know. Yeah. Having it trying to shoehorn it into a movie like this, it just feels clunky. I don't see the challenge to it. Like I said, I mean, it's going to cycle you back to those choices anyways. So it's like, where does that come in?
It kind of wants you to just go ahead and see all of the endings, see all the pathways, and it encourages you to...
Then what's the point?
Right.
What's the fucking point of the choices then? You may as well just link it up into this really weird, mind-twisty movie and just leave it at that. I mean, like I said, David Lynch did it with Inland Empire, and he did it well. That shit is a movie within a movie within a movie, and then cycles back to being real life again.
Crazy.
Yeah. It's that kind of crazy.
Or the couch gag and Hectic Knife.
Hectic Knife, the couch gag. Oh, my God. Jesus. I need to hit those guys up, man. It's like Litvin and DeSalva, I think their names were. Yeah, those guys were good.
You're kind of like that TV critic in Bandersnatch. The one that is just never pleased. He's on giving the game no stars or 2.5 stars out of 10 or 5.
Oh, please. I am much more charismatic than that motherfucker. I mean, come on, dude. That dude was literally a goddamn Ziploc bag full of cottage cheese made sentient and sapient. That's what he was.
Jesus gracious.
Robert, what'd you think about this movie?
I guess I let it play through when I first turned it on, and then I selected.
You actually just let the game or movie or whatever it is choose itself?
Just in the beginning. Okay. And then I started playing it.
I guess that's an approach.
Yeah. I don't know.
I was curious as to what would happen if you just let it play through. It does force you to choose one or two of the options.
Yeah.
Takes you back to the original option, I guess.
But well, people, let's not pretend that any of this is clever. Let's not pretend that any of this has been done before. Let's not pretend it's not derivative. Let's just not pretend that this is anything that's worth any more than maybe a month or two of analysis, and that's that. Seriously, this is going to be forgotten within another, probably when the new Black Mirror season starts. It'll be forgotten. That's what I think.
I think you guys maybe should give one or two episodes of the main series a try.
I don't know. Maybe. It's just I'm not that in a TV-watching frame of mind. I can binge some certain things, but I find myself binging stuff off of YouTube more often than not.
Great,
you know?
Great ever.
Yeah.
Movie reviews, cinema snobs.
Oh, cinema snob, of course. You know, AVGN, all that stuff.
Nostalgia Critic.
There you go.
Nostalgia Critic. I could binge that shit for hours, but you try to throw something like Black Mirror on, I'm just going to be like, is this over yet?
Well, it's something you don't necessarily have to binge. I think you can watch one episode every now and then because they have nothing to do with each other.
I understand they have standalone episodes, but even so.
I think it's honestly best to not binge Black Mirror myself. I think it's best done in 1 to 2 episode intervals because it gets you a feel of, because every episode is different. It really is. They have literally nothing to do with each other.
Yeah.
And because they're so independent, they're like watching different movies. And
so,
just
like
different
Outer
feel.
Limits or Tales from the Crypt?
Yeah.
Robert?
Hell yeah.
Even that's derivative. Jesus fucking Christ.
You guys have seen Tales from the Crypt, right?
Tales from the Crypt?
Yeah.
I have it.
Tales from the Crypt.
You're going to love it. I do have seasons.
Tales from the Crypt is amazing. That's amazing shit. Like, honestly. Classic horror, classic comedy.
Stuff we
awesome.
Both. They aired that for TV when it first came out. Or HBO did, right?
It was on HBO, and then they syndicated it, and it was on, like, WB back in the day.
I remember that.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's definitely a show you should watch other than Bandersnatch.
Dakota,
What are your final thoughts on this?
I liked it. I liked the format. Mm-hmm. I mean, I understand what Bo's saying, and I actually agree with most of his points. However, I enjoyed watching it.
Yeah,
and
I had so fun with it.
You can't take away my enjoyment of watching it, you know?
I guess that's fair.
It was okay to watch, right?
Yeah. I guess for me, my enjoyment of watching it kind of overrules my criticism sometimes. Sometimes I can tell, and that, like, this movie's terrible. Like, it wasn't even enjoyable, you know?
Yeah.
But if it was enjoyable, that kind of gives me a reason to kind of want to watch it.
It's a popcorn movie.
Yeah, it is a popcorn movie.
Netflix original.
Yeah, true. It's a Netflix original, and those are usually worth watching.
A lot of the Netflix originals I really like.
I don't know. There's just something about the Netflix originals that doesn't appeal to me.
Of course you disagree, like, Bo.
You seen Bird Box yet?
You're just a cynic, Bo.
I would like to check out Bird Box.
That looks really good.
It seems like a novel concept. I'd like to check it out.
That's the other one that's trending.
Yeah.
Took Bandersnatch's Thunder.
First day it was put out, dude.
Oh, yeah.
Took off.
Yeah,
it became a meme.
It's still number one. Yeah, it did.
Yeah.
Bandersnatch memed a little, too.
Bird Box memed more.
Yeah, Bird Box memed
more. Sandra Bullock. Oh,
that's right. Sandra Bullock. Hell yeah.
Well, that's our thoughts on Bandersnatch. So we encourage you to watch it yourself if you're subscribed to Netflix. And if you like Black Mirror, I think you should definitely check this out. If you have never seen Black Mirror, you don't like it, I think like any other episode of Black Mirror, check out another one, you know? So I think it's worth checking out just see how you feel about it. It doesn't take long. You'll get through the watch through. Take about an hour and a half, maybe. They filmed over 5 hours of footage for this, but in a typical watch through, you'll hit up maybe, 1.5 hours. So a lot of it's also duplicate scenes. I think it's an interesting concept. Maybe not completely executed correctly, but, you know, it was fun. So, guys, next time... 2 weeks from now, we're going to go ahead and drop our first regular episode of the season. We had our pilot episode. We have this collab special. Next episode, I guess, is kind of our inaugural, episode one officially. As we told you before, that is infamous Second Son. Dakota and I played it already. And during the break, we had a lot of fun with that.
Oh, yeah.
We're even getting ahead now and playing some of the other games we're going to do this season.
Yeah, you're going to be excited for the rest of the season because we've got some good games coming, and we've been playing through all of them.
And the next episode, of course, is going to be our Zelda episode. Now, the Instagram poll results are back, but just to keep the suspense going, I'm going to wait a little bit longer. It was actually a tie, but I asked my friend Steven, who I want to get joined on the podcast by the next episode, I asked him to break the tie, and he's not on Instagram, and so we have a winner, but y'all are going to have to wait till the end of next episode to get that. As for Collateral Cinema, I believe we're doing Ichi the Killer next, right?
Ichi the Killer. Yes, that is right. That is our anniversary episode, even though apparently the original pilot episode initially released February 3rd, but I think that's a screw-up. I remember uploading it in mid-January.
That's my boy.
But, yeah, we started with a Takashi Miike movie, and we're going to celebrate our anniversary with one. And this movie is so fucking twisted and so much fun to watch. It's a little long, but honestly, I recommend everybody watch it, and I recommend everybody come and check out our episode on it. It's going to be all kinds of fun. Hopefully, we'll have a new mixer then, even. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ooh. That'd be cool.
Well, guys, Collateral Gaming is on iTunes now. We're on Podbean. We are on Spotify. I don't know if we ever got back to Google Play. And as soon as we get our first video episode out, which it should be by the time you guys get this episode, we'll release those around the same time, we'll also be on YouTube. Collateral Cinema, you can find all those places as well.
Mm-hmm. And on Chill Lover Radio, and very soon Collateral Gaming will be on Chill Lover Radio as well.
That's correct.
Yes, you will.
We are super excited about the opportunity to be part of Chill Lover Radio. Since I started, I was hoping that we could take it under that wing as well with you guys.
Yeah.
Since we're kind of a brand together, so that's going to be exciting. We're going to release a lot of content for you guys. It looks like every week you're going to have something, either from cinema or from gaming. So if you're a big movie and video game buffs like we are, I think you'll have a lot of fun listening to us.
Certainly.
So I'm having a blast, and that's the most important part. I think we're all having a blast here, right?
Oh, yeah. I had fun tonight.
I like our discussion.
Yeah.
Even with your differing opinions.
Oh, whatever. Cast your judgment aside, Dakota.
With the plant kind of.
Yeah, exactly. And throw away all those peanut shells.
All right, guys. Well, once again, I am Ashley Chancellor, the better half of the Chancellor brothers.
I'm Dakota Chancellor.
I'm Robert Ortegon.
And I'm Bo Maddox.
We are Collateral Gaming and Collateral Cinema. Out.
Here comes the rain again.
It's a wrap.
Collateral Gaming and Collateral Cinema are El Company Productions. All music and movie clips are owned by their respective creators. Please don't sue us. We're poor.